As we saw in our earlier reports, President Moon Jae-in was in Singapore and Papua New Guinea for the ASEAN and APEC summits. But it was his meetings with the leaders from China, Russia and the US that perhaps caught the eye the most. It was hoped that these meetings could help rebuild momentum on denuclearization and peace talks with North Korea, which currently remain at a standstill. How did it go? Well, we'll try to assess that in this part of the show with the help of our guests here with me now. Now, to my right, we have Dr. Woo Jung-yeop, a research fellow at the Sejong Institute. And to my left, we have Shin Se-min, our correspondent at the Presidential Blue House. It's good to have you both here on the show today.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks for having me, too.
Now, Se-min, let me start with you. There was much focus on this trip because of this current stalled talks between North Korea and the U.S. And President Moon met with several leaders of the key nations involved, namely China, Russia and the U.S. You were there for the Singapore leg of his trip. Mm-hmm. How did the meetings go?
Well, looking back at President's six-day trip to both Singapore and Papua New Guinea, as you have mentioned, two things I want to point out. One, he has been pushing with his vision of establishing the inclusive nation and the inclusive growth, one that focuses on tackling the economic disparity while working to expand boost and cooperation with ASEAN and APEC member nations. And the other, of course, is bringing those countries that are not directly involved in North Korea-related diplomacy with the latest development happening on the Korean Peninsula. And as you have mentioned, Chang Ho, the sidelines of the summit, the South Korean leader also met with key players involved in the North Korea-related diplomacy, namely the Russian President Vladimir Putin, U.S. Vice President Mike Pence, and Chinese President Xi Jinping. And it seems as though having these summits for the first time since we've seen somewhat of a fallout between the North Korea and the U.S. Gained a lot of traction, regardless of the outcome of the summit.
So, Dr. Hu, it was hoped, as Se-min mentioned there, that these meetings that President Moon had with these three leaders would provide traction on denuclearization talks in North Korea. Do you think progress was made?
First of all, I think I have to point out that the main goal, main purpose of his trip this time, is not to meet these three leaders from these three countries. These are so-called like sideline meetings, and the first goal of having this trip is to have multilateral meetings with the ASEAN and the APEC leaders, and also President Moon want to push forward his agenda on new Southern policy with the leaders of those countries. So with regard to our North Korean policies, it is important to have strong relations with the leaders from these countries, U.S., Russia and China. That is why we have a keen interest on what's going on with these leaders. I think that we really didn't hear the answers that we want to hear from these leaders at this time, but the progress will be made by these kind of meetings kept going on in the future. So I think it has been a successful meeting this time.
So you think it was just about staying in touch rather than trying to move things forward significantly?
Yeah, so this is very short meetings with various leaders at the same locations. So it's very difficult to achieve the goals that we have. So I think, as you mentioned, that it's important to keep talking with these leaders over the course of all the processes that we have now.
Se-min, interesting. In his last overseas trip to Europe, President Moon notably brought up the issue of sanctions, possibly mm-hmm. easing them mm-hmm. on North Korea at some point in the future. Now, this was met with some resistance from the European leaders at the time. Was there any mention of sanctions this time during his trip?
Right, unlike the one that you've just mentioned, quite a different mood this time. President Moon stayed away from mentioning the North Korea's sanctions relief at the ASEAN and APEC summit, but he did mention it a bit during his one-on-one with Russian President Vladimir Putin, where the two leaders had agreed on the need for reciprocal measures from Washington if the Kim Jong-un regime makes progress on denuclearization. And the presidential spokesperson this morning addressed press reporters on that particular point, saying that the contents brought up during the meetings with different world leaders should not be evaluated in batches. Rather, he added that the respective relations, the two countries, as well as the ties with North Korea, were in consideration during the meetings that President Moon had been holding on the sidelines of the multinational summits. So whether or not a certain agenda had been discussed shouldn't be used to evaluate the outcome of the meetings. Those are the exact words from the presidential office spokesperson, saying that it's not just a matter of the contents that they're discussing this time.
But, you know, as our job as reporter, I think we always analyze on the little details that come out of it. And some of what they said as well. So let's move on to what President Moon said with the Chinese leader, Xi Jinping, as well. So when President Moon met with Xi, she said Beijing supports Moon's peace efforts and will try to play a constructive role, adding that the North Korea-U.S. summit and Kim's planned visit to Seoul will be crucial to those efforts. What should we make of Xi's comments here?
President Xi told our President Moon that he was indeed invited by Chairman Kim to visit North Korea this year. However, the situation does not allow him to visit Pyongyang this year. So he planned to visit both South and North Korea next year. And I think there are like political reasons why he wanted to visit two Koreas next year. One is that as China has this like confrontational relations with the United States these days, especially in the trading sections, that he does not, President Xi does not want to expand this battlefront even over to the North Korean side, North Korean issues. So earlier this year, when Chairman Kim visited North Korea, visited China to meet President Xi just before his summit with President Trump, there was a criticism from U.S. side that China actually instigate North Korea to go hard on the United States. So maybe China doesn't want to be looked at in that way again when North and U.S. has this stalled negotiation process right now. So if things are moving very smoothly between U.S. and North Korea, it might be easier for President Xi to visit Pyongyang anytime he wants. But since the relations between North Korea and the U.S. is rather colder than before, so I think the timing of visit North Korea is very political for him to make any decision. So that is why President Xi says at the same time he supported President Moon's policy toward North Korea, but at the same time he is very considerate in mentioning that when he's going to visit both Koreas next year.
So President Moon met with Xi and also Vladimir Putin, but the head of state that wasn't there was Trump, but he did send his VP Mike Pence, who was also President Moon met with there. And according to Blue House officials, what's interesting was Pence said he's said to have asked Moon that asked Moon to keep communicating with North Korea and keep talking to them. It seems Pence is emphasizing Moon's role as a mediator between the U.S. and North Korea. What do you think, Professor?
So just before his trip to Asia, Vice President Pence wrote an op-ed on newspaper emphasizing the sanctions and the strong pressure on North Korea until North Korea's denuclearization. So there was a little bit confrontation, not confrontation, but hard times between South Korea and the United States with regard to South Korea's policy toward North Korea in terms of improving the inter-Korean relations. So as long as South Korea is talking with the United States is not blocking South Korea's move toward North Korea. So the Steve Biegun, the U.S. State Department's special representative to North Korean policy visit earlier, and that we are going to make a working group, and I believe that South Korean delegations are now in D.C. to have these working group meetings. So I believe that what Vice President Pence mentioned to our president this time is a very principle that South Korea should have its role as long as South Korea is not violating the sanctions.
We'll get to that working group meeting in just a sec. But before we get there, Se-min, let me turn to you first as well. So this relationship between China, I feel, is very important for denuclearization talks, the relationship between China and North Korea. Of course, China is North Korea's closest ally. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't help right now that Beijing and Washington continue to have a turbulent relationship amongst themselves. There was another development in the trade dispute between these two superpowers at the APEC summit. I mean, can you tell us what happened there?
Right, the trade dispute between Beijing and Washington led to a standoff, even leaving the APEC without a joint communique for the first time in 29 years since the founding of the APEC summit. And the vice president, just to delve into some of the things that they've discussed at the meeting, the VP Pence attending the in-president Trump's place urged Asian nations to work with U.S., which he said would not saddle them with debt, in comparison to some of the partnerships that Beijing had been having that resulted in some debt issues. And Chinese President Xi Jinping insisted that such criticism was misguided and said that China's infrastructure plan would be inclusive and beneficial. But then again, this stalemate could perhaps set a high-stakes showdown at the G20 conference happening later this month, where the presidents of both Trump and Xi will be in attendance. So it's difficult to see whether the standoff that we saw from the APEC summit would carry on till the G20 summit. But as Dr. Wu had mentioned earlier, that in terms of from China's standpoint, it does not seem as if the two G2 leaders are trying to have the issue of economy and the trade issue, as well as the diplomacy with North Korea, get in the mix. So it seems as though, according to the doctor, from the Chinese standpoint, at least having them divided would at least hinder the progress being made on the North Korean diplomacy.
Dr. Su, can you expand on that a little bit further? Do you think this trade dispute between U.S. and China could have any effect on the North Korea talks?
So, earlier in 2017, that when President Trump and President Xi first met at the Mar-a-Lago, President Trump mentioned that because of North Korean issues, he did not bring up the trade issues with the Chinese leaders. But later that year, President Trump started to attack China with regard to its trade deficits. So it's apparent that President Trump is going to use these trade issues for his own domestic political issues. So I think that the two leaders understand that it's inevitable that they are going to confront in the line of trade issues, but at the same time that they are going to cooperate on North Korean issues at the same time. So the problem is that how they are going to separate or how they are going to mix those issues. And so far, it is said in Washington, D.C. that actually the most common factor between U.S. and U.S. and China these days is the North Korean policy. So as two leaders are having trouble with regard to these trade policies, I think they don't want to expand their battles over to the North Korean policy as well. So I think that the two leaders are going to find some place to reconcile their differences, and I think the starting point for that is North Korean policy. So I think so far the two leaders are not trying to mix trade policy with North Korean policy at this juncture.
And as promised, let's go back to that working group that we mentioned earlier. So Seoul and Washington officials are continuing to try their best to make progress on North Korea by themselves as well. South Korea's nuclear envoy Lee Do-hun is in the U.S. to meet with his U.S. counterpart, Stephen Biegun. And there might even be the first meeting of the working group that was announced previously. What do we know so far about that?
We seem to be seeing some progress being made. The new consultative body to coordinate the North Korea-related diplomacy seems to be shaping up for its official launch this week. As Dr. Wu had mentioned, we already know that both Seoul and Washington have agreed in principle to hold their first meeting of the working group during the upcoming visit to the U.S. by Seoul's top nuclear envoy, Lee Do-hun. And the special representative for Korean Peninsula Peace and Security Affairs, will represent Seoul, while Stephen Biegun will be representing the side of Washington, and they are expected to discuss preparations for the upcoming big summit between President Trump and North Korean leader Kim Jong-un. So we should look at the working group, because it's the first that we've been seeing between Seoul and Washington of having formed up a consultative body for the success of the Pyongyang-Washington relations. So something that we need to keep an eye on.
Dr. Hu, what do you think of this working group? I mean, this is a new body that's been made to tackle North Korea. Do you think it will have some sort of effect?
So the problem on these issues that it is very tricky that what part of our project with North Korea is actually violating the international sanctions and what part of the project can be moved on without being afraid of possibly by violating the sanctions. So for U.S. and South Korea, the close ally, they should consultate before make any move not to violate any international sanctions. So U.S. and Korea with various branches of the government gathered together to discuss whether certain action can be violating the international sanctions or whether certain actions can be moved on without without having any concerns on violating the sanction. So I think that especially this time that the South Korea's project with North Korea on the railroad, what part of railroad project can move on without violating sanction? I think that might be the key issue this time.
Well, we're out of time, so we're going to have to wrap things up there. Thank you both for coming in, and it's always great you get your insights.
Always a pleasure.
Thank you.